Hey everyone, I'm going to try this blue-white red Lotus, or if you want, Gear Hulk deck from H0lydiva on Twitter. It combines Lotus Field with Bloodsun and Tail's End, both of which basically prevent you from having to sacrifice the two lands when you play the Lotus, so you kind of just ramp up. Tail's End is already a pretty good card in Historic. It's really good against Sultai, for example. It counters Nissa, it counters Narset. It can stop making a token from Shark Typhoon. There's a lot of, you know, you can counter Uro when they play it back from the graveyard. So it has a lot of use already, and this deck kind of combines it pretty well with Lotus Field. It's really, really nice on turn three because it fits perfectly into the curve of, you know, land, abrade something. On turn three, play Lotus Field. Tails End the trigger. You don't have to sacrifice lands. All of a sudden, you ramp up to five mana on turn three. Turn four, you play your sixth mana source, and you can already cast something like Sublime Epiphany or Torrential Gear Hulk, you know, flashback the Tails End or abrade or something. So that seems kind of interesting. It's going to be definitely a fun deck. I don't know if it's going to be definitely tier one, but we can definitely try it. And Bloodsun, it's not as great as it once was when Field of the Dead was in the format, but it can still stop, you know, Fabled Passage from being able to be cracked for mana. So it basically just turns it into a complete brick. It stops ramming up ruins and can stop, you know, Gas Locked Wind, for example. Some of these lands are quite heavily played, so yeah, at worst it draws you a card, so it can't beat that bad. Narset's nice in this deck because there's a lot of 2-offs, 3-offs. It can find you Sublime Epiphany, it can find you Commit to Memory, which is really good with Narset because if you ever play the memory side of it, then they don't get to draw more than one card. Pact of Negation also sounds kind of interesting with Gear Hulk because you do ramp up to a lot of mana pretty quickly, and then you can just use the pact and pay for it. At first, when I was looking at the deck, I was like, there's so many expensive cards. There's no way you can play all these six drops. And then I noticed the Lotus Fields and all the combos. So that makes a lot of sense. I like this the removal package as well, because Sweltering Sands, you can just cycle it away if you don't need it against a control deck or something, so it's not really gonna rot in your hand as something like, you know, Anger of the Gods would, or some of the white sweepers like actual Wrath of God. Like, that's actually a card that, you know, doesn't really have any use against the control decks, but the Sweltering Sands, you can just cycle it away. And a Braid, that's a pretty versatile removal spell. You can just get rid of, you know, Witch's Oven, or against the combo decks it can kill Paradox Engine, for example, while still being an answer for something like Emery or, you know, Land of Werewolves or whatever. So yeah, I'm gonna give it a try. I don't know if it's, you know, definitely tier one. Also, the meta base kind of seems a little bit all over the place. I don't think this kind of decks usually wants to play the fast lands, because you usually just want to start with a tap line on turn one. So I like the four triumphs. I like the I like the cycling lands. That makes sense. Why can't we put it on top of each other? Okay. I like the cycling lands because on turn one, you're just always going to play a tap land. So, you know, six, maybe even eight lands wouldn't be a big deal. And then I like the check lands. They also make a lot of sense because you're going to have a lot of duels in this deck. So playing Clifftop Retreat, Glacial Fortress, or the blue-red one, they should almost always come into play untapped if you don't play the fast lands. Like with Triome, with the farmland, with four steam vents, with Sacred Foundry, like there's going to be a lot of duels for you to put these lands into play untapped. So I would be looking at replacing the fast lands with those, just to make sure that, you know, on turn four or six, when you want to have your sixth mana source for Gear Hulk, you're not going to draw this kind of land. And this deck is going to play long games, so for that reason I would be looking at possibly replacing these with lands that always come into play untapped. But yeah, I'm going to try it as is, and then we can make some conclusions after a few matches. Traditional, Historic, Ranked. Let's go! Oh, I haven't played in quite a while, so it looks like I dropped into some gold ranks, but I guess that's what happened over the Christmas break. This is not a great hand. I have a lot of expensive cards, but nothing really to do early. First, you should do is you should take a look at your opponent. If they're showing a companion, that always tells you a little bit about their deck. 500 to mulligan this one. Okay, this seems a lot better. I'm gonna send back one abrade and hopefully, yeah, this is not gonna be a problem in this game because it's gonna come into play on tap on turn two, so that's second to Lotus. But if this was a line a little bit later, it could be awkward. The nice thing about Lotus is sometimes you can just normally play it, you know, on turn three. You sack two lands, sure, it still produces the extra mana that you would get from a normal land. So it's not like something you can't really play if you don't have the second part of your combo, for example. I think I'll just get rid of the oven here. Wow, they didn't even use it? What is going on? I think I'll get rid of the oven so that they don't get to do this free loop every turn. Yeah, priest I'm not really worried about, so you can have that. If they played something like a Mayhem Devil, maybe I would have abraded that. But no, I'm just gonna get rid of the Witch's Oven to stop the loop. This kind of looks like I have to play the field here. I mean, I guess I don't really have to. I can just play both of my lands first. Yeah, I'll actually just do that. Like, this way I can play commit next turn. If I draw a land, I can play Teferi. It's a lot better to not have to sacrifice land, so maybe I'll draw Blood Moon or Blood Sun. Or Tail's End. It could definitely be a problem, like not being fast enough against the aggressive decks. Okay, that's good against control, for sure, because it just keeps coming back every time you play land. Narset. So it's either Narset and Lotus Field to make sure that I can play Teferi next turn, or play on tap land, hold, commit. Probably just do Narset. I think I need to draw into something like a Sweltering Suns. I don't really mind if they attack it down. At least it's gonna save me some life. And also this way I can see if I draw like a Thousand or something. Sylvan Division, okay. So that can also be a land. So now the question is, do I still want to play the Lotus or do I just play that as a land? I think I would like to use this to try to search for a Sweltering Suns or something. I don't really want to play the Lotus Field, but I don't really feel like I have another option. Yeah.
My mind needs a rest.
So what they should have done is that they should have probably used the priest, activated to sack both of the creatures, let them draw another card, make me lose two, the shade goes into the graveyard, and then when they play the castle, they can just replay it from the graveyard for free. I don't really want to play Teferi, but I also, again, I don't feel like I have too many options here. It's gonna untap two lands. Yeah, I guess it can get protected by the commit or Shark Typhoon, so that's actually okay. It's actually okay here. Let's slow this down. Probably gonna be able to make it survive. Okay, land's nice. Oh, I already played one, never mind. Never mind. Untap Lotus, untap Triome. If it survives a turn, hopefully next turn I can try to use this to find the Sweltering Suns. Good thing is I'm still at 15. Because the Narset soaked them some damage and they didn't really have too much of a clock. Mayhem Devils. I could either commit that, I could commit the Priest in response. The problem with that is that they're gonna still have some mana floating. I guess it's not the end of the world if I commit the Priest in response. Like, they will get two more mana, they will get to play probably something else from their hand. But if they want to use the Priest, they will have to sack both the creatures and then they can't attack. The other option is to commit the Shade so that the fairy is unlikely to die. Yeah, if I commit the Priest, then a Fabled Passage or Witch's Omen or something in response just kills the Mayhem Devil. But if I commit this, they can... Yeah, I think I'm going to commit the 3-1. I could also commit the Mayhem Devil, but then the Teferi just dies, and I don't really want to let that happen. So yeah, if you want to use your Priest, go ahead. Means Teferi stays at 5, and it's very, very unlikely it dies. But I will need to find the removal spell next turn. At some point, hopefully, I also start drawing Gearholics, and then I can start flashbacking the Abrades and everything. Discontinuity also kind of seems like it might be a little bit too cute for this deck. But we'll see. I think I would just want to maximize the power of Gearholics and Shark Typhoon, so I would just probably play 4 of each. And Gearholic lets you flashback memory? How does that work? Torrential Gearholic.
You're not going to win this.
Or is it only an instant? Okay, I start an instant. Okay. So you can only flashback the commit side of it. Ooh, Chandra is kind of a problem.
When people start screaming, I know. Today's my lucky day.
Okay, so now what? I can bounce Chandra, make a copy of Mayhem Devil. I kind of need them to play a card first, though. So if I plus Teferi, I could use Teferi on Chandra. Like, bouncing Chandra doesn't really help me too much. I mean, I could just minus Teferi on Chandra. Like, the fairy's gonna die, but that's not the end of the world. And I'm gonna have this up. The problem is I have to shock myself to do it. Yeah, I'm actually gonna do that. I'll say goodbye to the fairy here. I'll play on tap land and pass. If they attack with the Mayhem Devil, I'll just make a 4-4 token from the Shark Typhoon and block it. If they play something first, then I'll play the Sublime Epiphany. The fairy dies, but at this point I'm not that much worried about not having enough value. Like it's unfortunate, but what are you gonna do? It's an interesting game, actually. I kind of wish I had a few more cheaper cards or a Gear Hulk. Ooh, okay, so I'm gonna counter that. Counter target spell. Return and draw. I'm gonna bounce this guy, and I'm gonna draw a card. Ooh, okay, you'll have to see that. Torrential Gear Hulk, flashing back your Epiphany, and copying the Gear Hulk again. That is some pretty decent value. Yep, the fairy dies.
How long do you want to wait for?
So I could play Triumph or I could play Steam Vents. At this point, I think I might just want to cycle the Triumph rather than play it though. So yeah, I'm just going to play tap Steam Vents and pass. Yeah, Gearhawk plus Epiphany, that is some serious value right there. I think I might just play the Gear Hulk anyways. Draw a bunch of cards. Or is it Shark Typhoon? Might actually be Shark Typhoon. Yeah, I'll actually play Shark Typhoon because I need the Gear Hulk to counter this Chandra next turn. Problem with Shark Typhoon is they can steal it at some point with Claim and just fuel their priest. Gearhulk's usually pretty safe. I wonder if the Lotuses are even necessary. Like if you can just play a normal, you know, normal Jeskai deck. Though against something like Sultai, it is nice to be able to Gear Hulk and flashback like a Tails End, you know, to counter their Uro, to counter their Nissa. Skyclave Shade, right? Yeah, having Bloodsun here would be really nice because it would also stop them from being able to draw extra cards with the castles. Yeah, there's a Claim. And they just use it right away, which is a little bit surprising. Like, you would think that they would probably try to wait for next turn to give the... Oh, yeah, they're drawing Chandra. Never mind. Of course, that makes more sense.
Do you want to go, tough guy?
Yeah, Chandra is a problem.
Oh, this is gonna hurt.
Ooh, okay. Well, that's not great. So what now? I think I just pass. This is so awkward. I don't want to. I don't want to have to play the Lotuses because that just doesn't work. So I guess I have to play the Triome. Like the Lotuses are being super awkward in this game. Like it is an actual liability now that I can't just play this as a normal land. And then cycle the Triome. Because if I play this, I have to sacrifice two lands. But I really want to be able to instead use them on my own turn.
Yep, you're going down.
To use them on my opponent's turn, so I don't have to sack them because, well, that's not going to work. So this I will probably counter. So they can't priest me. Oh, is this one of those bugs where you can't select the card? It is literally impossible to go to the card behind commit to memory. Oh my god. Okay. So, counter that spell. Return, create, and we draw. Okay. We bounce this. We bounce priest. We copy this guy, we draw a card. And now I can kill the Mayhem Devil, or I can put Chandra on top. But if I kill their creatures, then I could just attack Chandra down. They just passed. That's interesting. If you're going to use Castle, you should just do it on your own turn. So I wonder if they have something like an Abrade to kill the Gearhulk. Let's start with the load with the Blood Sun. That we all know what's going on. Okay, so this is very likely getting to kill their Chandra. Now I can play the Lotus for free. I wonder if I should actually just attack them and try to go for lethal, but that doesn't seem necessary. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So I can cycle. Yeah, I can kill them. Probably next turn, regardless. Actually, is it better? This is really interesting. Normally, when you can't finish them off in one swing, you should almost always kill the Planeswalker. But in this situation, I wonder if it's just better to go for the Shark Typhoon. Like, I attack them. They don't really have anything with haste. So if they're at 5, I just cycle Shark Typhoon at end of turn. That just wins me the game. Like, Chandra can put me at 5. Like, they can't really... I guess they could claim their own priest and activated that way. I've already dealt with 2-3 Mayhem Devils. It's really unlikely I'll take 5. I'll actually attack them. Is that stupid? It can be really unnecessary. Like, how am I going to lose if I kill Chandra? Let's see. The only reason why I didn't kill Chandra was that with the two Skyclave Shades, like, it could get a little bit awkward. Like, we would be in some kind of standoff. Like, they can just start using their priest. Yeah, I'm not really sure what's cracking this in this spot. But I think it's pretty unlikely I take 7 here, no matter what happens. Like, they can't claim any of my guys because they cost too much. This is fine. Unless they play something like an Act of Treason, that would be bad. But I can still block with the Shark Typhoon token, I guess. And it's even going to be a 6-6. This has been a pretty interesting game. Float double red, okay. Yeah, it looks like they don't think they can get killed by the Shark Typhoon. They're just trying to survive against the two Gear Hulks and give themselves one more turn so that they can use Chandra for the emblem next turn, probably. Yep. Now they can play Priest. Yeah, and they die to the Flyer. Yeah, Gearhulk plus Sublime Epiphany, that was quite a ride. That was a pretty solid turn. Discontinuity is also kind of a counterspell. Like, it can be a fog if you want, because it can just end the turn, you don't take any damage. But it is pretty expensive. It can counter Uro. It's like an Uro counter. Is that how it works? It is how it works, right? Discontinuity. MTG. Oh no, that's a different. Okay, I'm thinking of a different card. It has to be your turn. So you can stop your own Uro if you want from like a different kind of deck. Sure. I mean, either way, they can't stop the Shark Typhoon, so it doesn't really matter. Like, they can make me sack one of the tokens, but that's... It doesn't matter. Not tokens, one of the Gearhulks, I mean. Alright. As long as it's your turn, the spell costs 4 less to cast. So Anger of the Gods seems like a card I really want. Leyline, I don't know. Like, it stops the Shades, but I don't... Like, it's obviously for this kind of matchup, but I'm not really sure if I want that. Like, Anger already exiles the creatures, so if I'm dealing with their board, like, it's going to get exiled. Pact is too expensive for sure. Tails and doesn't really do much against their deck. It's obviously, you know, in combination with my Lotus, that's the main point, but... I don't really want to have a card that's otherwise blank in my deck, I don't think. Like, it stops Chandra, okay. I don't want to use it to like stop the Skyclave trigger so it doesn't come back. Like, that's basically like countering a land trigger for one turn. The next turn you just play another land, do it again. That's not really a good use of a card. This seems pretty bad against their deck. Gust is okay. They have Chandra, Mayhem Devil. Claim their pie board out, so they're probably playing the 3-1 over Butcher, is my guess. So I guess Gust doesn't seem all that great. Stroke's too expensive. Narset seemed pretty decent because helps me find the sweepers. Shark Typhoon I might not need because the token gets claimed, but they should board out claim, so yeah, that shouldn't be in their deck. I'm gonna board out some Talisands. Timely is blocks as a shade, which is good. It's not really great against a deck with Mayhem Devil, but I guess I can use it to slow them down. So the question is, do I want ley lines or not? And I don't really think I need them. Like, also, what do you board out if you bring in four ley lines? Maybe you just board out the Lotus stuff. Maybe I just board out two more Talisands. I kind of just want to try it out some more, though. I want to see how good does it feel to do that on turn three and just immediately go into casting six drops. Oh yeah, this is also a card you can probably board out in this kind of matchup. Because, like, just using your turn three to draw cards is pretty slow. I guess I'll keep this hand just on the back of Timely. Hope that they don't have a Mayhem Devil. Oddsies. Okay. I guess we're losing the Timely. I feel like what this deck needs is more cards for 2 mana. This is a Triumph. Turn. Go try. Yeah. So I can play Canal on turn 3 into Awakening. I'll probably ditch the Lotuses. I'll just probably ditch like my entire hand actually. Just try to search for like an Anger or something. The other option is to play the Lotus and just have it as a land that produces 3, but that doesn't sound good enough. It's nice that I picked up a counter for Chandra. One of the things I'm really looking forward to from the new set, by the way, is the red-black land, which would make the pathway, which would make the mana base of this deck a lot better, and also the blue-white one, which should make the mana base of blue-white auras significantly stronger as well. So, I could Jwari Disruption this, but I could also just play the Awakening and try to find the Sweeper, and I don't really care about the Strider. It's interesting. And keep the Disruption for later, like when they bring back the Strider, for example. I think I'll just go for the Awakening. Although if I don't find the Sweeper, I'm kind of just dead. Yeah, I have to do it, I think. I don't really want to be too all in on the Awakenings. I could do it now on my own turn. Oh boy. So that I can play one of the Lotuses. If I want to play Awakening, discard my hand. How about that? Play Land Pass seems bad. Sure. I could keep one of the Lotuses so that I still have a land to play. Well, there's the Tail's End. So do I wait? I guess I wait. The problem is it still comes to play tapped. This is so awkward. Four. Yeah, I guess this way if I draw a line, I'm going to be able to play Tail's End on the Lotus and still Anger. 1, 2, 3, 4. Do I wait one more turn? Lotus, Tails End. But the problem is it's still tapped. It still doesn't let me play Anger. It doesn't let me Tails End? What the hell? Are you kidding me? It doesn't just give you the stop. Oh my god, Arena! How do you not get the stop when there is a trigger? Does it only give you the stop if it's your opponent's cards? Well, the more you know. The more you know. I guess we're going to be countering a priest activation at some point. Well, lesson learned. You have to hold control when you play Tails End. Because some triggers you have a... You just get the priority automatically. Some triggers you don't. Sure. My turn, huh? Okay. So I guess this is a Sweltering Sun's turn because the creatures are not gonna get exiled anyway. The question is, do I counter the priest activation to deny them a card? I don't think so. Because Tails End can let me counter like a Chandra, which would be a pretty big deal. So I'll just let that resolve. The two extra mana is not that big a deal. Although I guess it was two extra cards because they did get to activate Castle that way. The fact that there are 12 doesn't really matter, like their life total rarely matters. Shit can come back. Hopefully they play two creatures. I can next turn play Anger and actually get rid of the shade that way. Yeah, we're gonna counter that. So now I can play Gear Hulk. Okay, so I can also do Valakut's Awakening here rather than just sit and wait. And I'll probably ditch Abrade and the Anger. Because I do need to draw some cards. Wonder if they have Abrade for the Gear Hulk now. Yeah. I think I have to get rid of both. Yeah, I'll keep one Anger. Shark Typhoon is nice. And Braid Anger. Okay, so I can play Land Pass. I can block the Shade when they attack. Still send back the Sweeper a little bit more. Problem is that the 4/4 is exactly the right size to... Okay, never mind. Okay, so timely reinforcements would be kind of the perfect draw. So by playing this untapped, I can still cycle and play a Braid. Or something like a Juza Disruption. Sure. I can respond to... Why didn't they just play the Vost Rider from the graveyard? That's interesting. If I kill this in response, they don't get to... Scry by sacking the token. I'll do it, I guess. I'm gonna have to kill it regardless, so I might as well just do it now. Bloodsun, Torrential, Gearhulk. So we're gonna get Awakening or a Braid. Thale's End does not really work. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight. Thale's End does not really work on Escape, right? Escape is not a triggered or activated ability. It's just, it's a call. It's a. Does that work? That is fine. Yeah, I was gonna upgrade the Mayhem Devil, but this just exactly kills me. Escape is a keyword ability. Spells can be cast from the graveyard for their escape cost. Yeah, it's just a cost. I don't think it's a... It's an activation or anything. Claim their guy. I mean, I die anyways. Doesn't matter what I do. I could try it. It's really strange to me that they left Claim in their deck, by the way. That doesn't really seem like a good use of a card. You found the line. I mean, at this point, I could try to wait for them to crack the line and try to Thale's End the one damage trigger, but if they're claiming the Mayhem Devil, then they're attacking me first without doing that, so they're playing around it, so it doesn't make sense to do it. I still don't really want to bring in the Ley Line. Like, it doesn't seem worth it. Like, the thing with Leyline is you're not guaranteed to have that card in your opening hand, and if it's not in your opening hand, it's really bad. It would be a lot better on the draw than on the play. Like, on the play, again, I could still rather try to go for the Thale's End combo, which I still want to try a little bit more because I don't really care about winning the match. I just want to learn more about the deck. That is only one land, unfortunately. So I guess we ditched the Oof. Narset's actually pretty good with the timely. The problem is I don't have a second blue source. I could ditch a Gearhulk, but Gearhulk is usually one of the... Yeah, I have to ditch a Gearhulk, I guess, from this hand. It's my best card against their deck, but I guess with... Yeah, this hand is just too bad. I don't even have anything to flashback. It was Gearhulk or Shark Typhoon. In Shark Typhoon, I can cycle early to find more lands. I could play Narset, but if I play Narset, it just dies, and I would rather get both of the activations from it, so I'll just play Timely here without gaining any life. Oh, I guess I should have Shock... Yeah, I messed this up. I should have not played the Shockland on turn 2, I should have played it on turn 3 to guarantee that I had less life, and that would have gained me life from Timely. I should have definitely done that. That was bad on my part. I could have just gained 4 more life. Blue-white control players know that trick just by muscle memory, but it's my first time playing with the card for after a really, really long time. I can play Vision here as a land. I could take Bloodsun. And then if I ever draw Lotus, that'd be really good. I could also take the Fairy. I'll take the Fairy here, I think. One nice thing about this deck is that Narset can actually find two lands. Like Narset finding Vision or Valakut's Awakening is just actually finding a tapped land, which is really cool. I'll do some chump blocking now. If they add more creatures to the board, I can just anger next turn. Sure, that's fine. So they can sag this to kill the token, but I still get to chump both. So Narset should stay alive. Oh, okay. Not anymore. Yeah, now Narset's dying because they get to kill that. Fable Passage is so good in their deck. Okay, so I'll take a lot of... Yeah, now the 4 life is probably going to cost me this game. 16... 14... 13... I'll get 13. Hopefully I draw a land to play this. The problem is they have double red. Now they can find Chandra or something to play the turn after. Which would be pretty unfortunate. They're reconsidering the top card, so that's good. If it was a Planeswalker, they would have 100% kept it, because there's nothing better you can play on an empty board against a control opponent when they're tapped out than a Planeswalker. They have 4 in the graveyard now? Yeah, I don't know about the Lotus combo. Like, so. Okay, well, there it is.
You want to play with fire, huh?
Okay, this is the actual worst that could have happened. Because now, if I use the Fairy to put Chandra back, then. The Fairy dies to the Shade. So that is pretty bad. I think I just have to Teferi, untap 2 lands, and hope that I either draw a land and then I can play a Shark Typhoon and block this.
You know what? I'm not done.
Yeah. That sucks. So I basically just don't have a play. I can cycle Shark Typhoon anyway for an extra card, but that doesn't really do much for me.
Yup, you're going down.
Maybe they just don't really have a way to deal with the Therian. In that case, I would still be in it. Oh, they're attacking me. Okay. Interesting. Okay, they actually just have it all.
I suppose that's how it was meant to happen.
I really don't want to cycle Shark Typhoon. I need the 6 line. There's nothing I can do. I need to be able to bounce Chandra. It's a tapped land. It doesn't really help. So now they are going to be able to go off. What can I find with Narset? Disruption, Abrade, not too much. Well, this I'll have to do. I can find Timely, but I still have to deal with Chandra. Because this just buys me some life. Yeah, none of that does anything. So this dies, I go to 6.
This will be easy.
Oh my god, Totsies. That's not good. Yeah, they were able to get me pretty well with the Planeswalkers. Like, we get to sight in all the sweepers, but the Planeswalkers are just really, really good. And it's incredibly hard to deal with this kind of deck. Like, the Fairy is basically my only answer. Or I have to counter it with Tail's End. But they used exactly that one turn when I had to play the sweeper.
Prepared for this.
Can I beat a Chandra emblem? That would require me drawing. Yeah, I don't even know. I guess I can Tails End the trigger. That's not it. If I had a Tails End here, I would be able to stifle the getting the emblem. One, two, three, four, five, six. Well, I can hope that they don't do it next turn. Yeah, I'll anger now. And just pass. Hope that they don't go for the emblem. But it's incredibly unlikely. All they need to do is just activate Castle, find literally just one spell. Or two spells, I guess. They don't have the card in the graveyard. And then we have Gearhulk for the Epiphany, which would also stifle the emblem. Okay, yeah. No, we're just dead.
Let's light it up.
Actually, just that. All right. That was a close match. The Lotus Bloodsun stuff was definitely a pretty big downside. Because a lot of the time, the Lotus has made it really awkward woodland to play, and like we never really got it together. I wish I had more check lands also. I had to shock myself a lot in that match. And I kind of also wish I had more like action cards. It also just feels like you're kind of just dirtling around and you know, you only really have the Fairy Gear, Hulk, Shark Typhoon, and the rest is just like, you know, a little bit of a sweeper, a little bit of a counterspell, more counterspell, more counterspell. But I feel like this deck probably wants a fourth Gear Hulk. I'll make a few changes as we go. Gear Hulk, because that just feels like the best card ever. I'll just ditch this, I think. Six. The vision is kind of not that great. How many lands do I have? 8, 10, 11, 20. Is this only 23 lands? That's crazy. 8. It is 23 lands. That's really interesting. So with the... Obviously, it's more like 27, but... Yeah, I also don't really know about the Pact. Of course, Pact is not really, you know... Against the aggressive decks, it's also it's always going to feel like the Pact is bad against aggro, but it's great against Sultai. I wonder if I can make some more. Definitely don't want the Inspiring Vantage. I also don't think I want a Sacred Foundry. I'm gonna have I don't think I can have. I want to have a Sacred Foundry, so I'll add one more retreat. Do I need another white source? I kind of have already a lot of white sources. 4, 6, 8, 9, 13 with the Lotus. 13 is enough for Teferi. It's not enough for timely against aggro, though. Yeah, sure, I'll add one more. Alright, let's go. I wonder if the Pacts are just a card meant for the sideboard. Alright, give me some Lotus hands. We have a lot of ways to stifle the Lotus trigger, but not a whole lot to do if we'd never find it. Well, I guess I'll keep, like, this draws another card. Bait Actor. I guess this is what happens to me a lot of the time when you accidentally queue with the wrong deck. Like into the wrong format. And you just don't want to waste time, you know, playing out your standard teamer adventures against people playing with a row in Historic. But no, they're still here. We'll see. Alright, so this is the turn 3 Lotus. A lot of tap lands though. Blue black control, huh? The problem is they're just gonna come through my Tails End. So I'll have to stack the lands anyway. Sultai. I could just play Bloodsun. That's honestly just better. Because that way I'll just jump to 6 mana. The problem is if they have Spiral into Nissa and another green land, that'd be bad. They just drew their first green source, so they didn't have another one. But if they do, that would be real bad for me. Okay, okay. Dodge the bullet to here. So now I just get to play Lotus. The question is, do I even want to play it now? Yeah. I'll use the 3 mana cycle of Triumph. Yeah. Alright. So now Bloodsun is nice. It stops them from ever using the castle. Yeah, we'll get to counter Nissa. That lines up perfectly. I would rather keep the Sluttering Suns than the land at this point, because this can get rid of Nissa lands. Solid, solid. Is this a tap land though? Is this a tap land? Turn. No. Just because it adds 3 mana instead of 1 doesn't mean it's better to play than, you know, it's a better sequence than just playing a tap land here. Like, if it lined up better for me to do tap land here and I still had exactly enough mana to do everything I wanted, then I would just do that because no reason to shock myself in the future. But the 3 extra mana allows me to... Whoa, cycle this for 0? That's crazy. That allows me to play Gearhulk and still... Cycle Switch, Sweltering Suns, for example. So, I thought they were gonna Uro, but they needed the fifth card from the... Okay. That's what happened. So now if I play Gearhulk, I'm a little worried that they're just gonna have a Tail's End. And they are getting priority, which they only do if they have something that can... that they can play. They don't get priority for something like Fatal Push. There's not a creature in play. I don't think they have another Grow Spiral because they already played 3. They could have a Shark Typhoon. That's what they could have. That would also make sense because you don't want to cycle Shark Typhoon if you have already a lot of lands in play, unless your hand has, you know, 3 more and you're looking for more lands or something. So they could definitely have a Shark Typhoon. I really don't want to play Gearhulk into the Tail's End though. So I think I just pass. Go into my turn. Keep playing lands and wait for my opponent to tap out, I guess. Also, I'm not really doing anything by playing the Gearhulk. I can't really like draw cards or anything. Yeah, there's the Shark Typhoon, so now I Gearhulk and Tail's End to deny them the token. I can stop them from drawing a card, I can stop them from making a token. I don't want them to make the token. I have another Tail's End for the Uro next turn, and I can start attacking for 5. Although it would still take me quite a while to finish the game, but I think this deck could use something like a... Like, you want to be able to flash something nice back with Gearhulk, and it feels like you only really have a Braid and... A Braid Pact and an Epiphany, so you kind of just only have 8 cards. I guess Awakening is a card draw. And Commit to Memory, sure. I was wondering if you could play, like, Hieroglyphic Illumination, maybe Glimmer of Genius. Glimmer is pretty expensive. It doesn't really go in well into the curve, but Hieroglyphic Illumination could be a consideration. The only issue with that is it's just not a good card. Just a little bit too weak. Like, Historic is a format with like a lot of really, really powerful magic cards. Like, people are playing Uro, they're playing Chandra, they're playing Collected Company, they're playing Thoughtseize. So playing Hieroglyph like Elimination against those kind of cards is usually not where you want to be. I also wonder if you need that many sweepers. Like, there really isn't that many aggro decks in Standard, in Historic right now. I mean, there are some on Ladder, but They all kind of just get farmed with Uro. I wonder if you just want to play more Narsets, because Narset just is really, really nice because it can find you Bloodsun. And it also just curves out really nicely. Like, you can play turn 3 Narset, activate it, find your Bloodsun, and next turn play the Bloodsun for the 3 mana you already have, and then play the Lotus to have 3 more mana afterwards. So the like it goes really, really well into the whole curve. So I wonder if you should just have another Narset in the main, possibly just play 4, and you can put something like a Sweltering Suns into the sideboard, maybe? Oh, you do actually, you have 29 lands because you have the Disruption as well. I've been liking the Disruption. The Disruption has been kind of nice. I don't know about the Vision. Like, getting just an instant or sorcery is also... Yeah, I'm going to cut the Vision. Like, you want to play your card draw. Like, if you play Awakening, that makes sense. You have a lot of clunky cards in your deck that if you don't draw them with the other card that you need, they're going to be really awkward, or you don't want to, you know, draw multiple Bloodsuns, or you don't want to draw multiple Talesuns against aggro. So sometimes being able to just play with Valakut's Awakening and just discard all those cards you don't have any use for is nice, because it's going to allow you to draw a lot of new cards. The problem with Vision is a lot of the times I'm looking for specific for my like game winning threats. You know, I'm going to be looking for Teferi, I'm going to be looking for a Torrential Gear Hulk. And if I play Silo Division, it does let me look at top 6, but I can't take one of my best cards. I can't take Gearhulk, I can't take Teferi, I can't take Narset, I can't take lands. So it's pretty much just finding Talesend, a Braid, you know, some sweepers, maybe like a counter. I don't have a great feeling about the card. I could just see playing another Disruption. Like, having a Force Spike is kind of nice. You don't want to have too many of those, obviously. But with the Awakenings, like, it kind of just makes sense, I think. So yeah, I'm just going to ditch one of the Visions. Also, I just want to have more 2 mana cards in the deck. Especially to just try to make my Narset survive the turn. All right, let's play one more match. It's an interesting deck. It's a cool deck. It's a cool idea. You know, it might not be fast enough for the format, but definitely as a tier 2 deck or something to explore moving forward is nice to keep an eye on. I was gonna say that's a really nice hand with Talesend and everything, but we actually just have a really, really awkward hand because we don't have blue mana for the Talesend. Yeah, I mean, I have to keep anyways, I think. I should have also got the Sweltering Suns for my sideboard for a fourth Anger. Anger is just better than Sweltering Suns. That didn't make sense. Let's switch. Is it even this? I think so. Awkward. Yeah, now having a untap line would be a lot better. I can still do it on turn 3 though, so I'll just take an extra damage, that's not a big deal. Yeah, I'm gonna have to play the first Lotus Field just normally, but then I can play Bloodsun next turn, play Lotus Field, untap the lands. I got Lures back. I guess I could just play Bloodsun now. Keep my Braid for the Lures, and then stifle the Bowman trigger at some point. That sounds reasonable. Ooh, I'm gonna be able to Sublime Epiphany next turn, that's really cool. Yeah, maybe for ladder purposes I shouldn't have got the third sweeper. Lotus. Are they just gonna discard their hand now? So we could just go. We could just go for the. We get rid of their entire hand here, by going Abraid on the Bowmat if they decide to draw four, because their hand is probably bad. They probably have claims and stuff. Then. I just stifle the trigger, so they end up with no cards, no Bowmat. The problem is that they can just play cards at the graveyard next turn from thanks to Lurus. I can't really use the Lotus Field to get blue unless they do all that together. So I abrade. Do I just abrade using? Yeah, I abrade using the two lands. That's the best way to do this. I could. If I had one more blue mana, I would abrade using the Lotus mana. But yeah, this is the best way to do this. I guess I could have also just taken four and hold the Sublime Epiphany. Maybe that would have been better. But I kind of, at this point, I kind of just want to hold the Thalesin for the Bowmat. I don't know. No, I'll cycle. I have to cycle. Okay, now we just. Now we can just do anything, pretty much. Yeah, when you draw the Blood Sun plus all the Lotuses, that does feel nice.
I know 88 ways to defeat you. Pitch, meditate, and prepare.
It's probably a second Narset, actually. Just make sure I get more sources of new cards. Got it. At this point, I can never just step out completely. Yeah, I have to. At this point, I will always have to keep up the stifle mana. So they already attacked, so they can. So this does nothing right now. I could draw. Can bounce my own Narset. I can also. We'll just Thalesin. They're very likely gonna scoop, probably, anyways. Yeah. Like, no reason to use the Epiphany on it, because this way you just hold like a normal counter spell. So yeah, this should be the fourth Anger. That should be swapped. So yeah, Anger is going to be great. Their deck is all creatures with low power, low toughness. It's going to be Arcanist, Young Pyromancer, Bowmat Courier, Anger for the 1-1 that mills 3 is also important that it gets exiled right away. Yeah, we bring in the Angers. I don't know if I want to have that many sweepers though. I feel like having just like 4 is probably enough, maybe 5. Leyline is definitely good against this deck. Like, this is just a deck that, you know, everything they do just interacts with the graveyard. Like, it's Kroxa, it's Claim, it's Arcanist. It's just way too many cards. The 1-1 that mills 3 just turns into a blank. So against this deck, I do want to have Leyline. Like, the red-black deck we played against, the Sacrifice deck, that just doesn't really care about Leyline sometimes. Like, sure, you know, you're not going to be able to bring back the Shade, but it's still a 2-mana 3-1, which is okay to pressure the opponent. So back those out. Thales and Some Talisman can go out. Narset on the draw can be a little bit slow. Yeah, I just need to make space for the ley line somehow. Timely is pretty decent against them. Board on one disruption. I could board on more disruptions, honestly. Like, they just have one mana and two mana cards. So you're very rarely going to get to counter anything. On the play, it's a lot better. On the play, you can counter Arcanist, like, with your two mana against their two. But on the draw, this almost does nothing. I don't want to board out too many of these because it's effectively boarding out lands, but this is still leaving me with 27, so that's okay. Can board out one Shark Typhoon. She just has more sweepers, honestly. Can board out one Commit as well. No, I think I like Common. I'll try it like this. Maybe I should have left in Narset. It's still a nice card to have, like with so many sweepers, you do want to have some Planeswalkers. Leyline, spells to play. Put this in play. Want to mill three? Thoughtseize. Yeah, I guess we're going to lose the Gearhulk, but it's not a big deal. Ooh, we lost a vision? Interesting. Interesting. Interesting choice. Yeah, Leyline here is just absolutely brutal. They need to find Feed the Swarm, otherwise their deck just does nothing. I don't even want to bother with the 1-3 right now. Like, I think I would just rather save a Braid for Lurrus. Lurrus isn't really going to do much, but it's still a 3-2. This is just literally not going to do anything. So yeah, I'll just take a few damage from it. I don't really mind. And just hold the Abrade for something potentially better. Yeah, the Leyline here was absolutely brutal. Bloodsun. Can draw into Lotus? Sure. Oh yeah, it also stops the shock effect on your duel, so they just always come into play on tap. That's also nice. That's weird, I thought that the pay 2 life was a thing, like, as it's coming into play, like, when you're sort of casting it, but I guess, not casting lands, but... Alright, well, that was interesting. That was a fun deck to play. I think it's definitely, you know, something worth trying out some more. I think the mana base definitely needs some work. Not sure about the third disruption, maybe 2 was the correct number. Like, maybe 10 2 mana spells is still okay, although Talisman is not really going to be a 2 mana play you can use against aggressive decks most often. The fourth anger, something we should put into the sideboard rather than the other card. Gust, Shark Typhoon. Too timely seems reasonable. Like, you don't need to have that many sweepers and timelies and you know, that much anti-creature stuff when there really isn't all that much aggro on ladder or in historic right now. One is the infrastructure. Yeah, it's nice to have counters because you flashback the counters against control or Sultai. So I think the fourth anger in the sideboard makes sense. The question is, do you actually need it? You could just have three. Yeah, if you're cutting something, you can just cut one anger. You don't need to have 6 3 mana sweepers. It is really, really good against company decks, though. It is going to be your best card against company decks. Like, angering away, you know, Cad, Dreadhorde Butcher, Vostrider, that all just seems really important. So yeah, 3-4 anger sounds reasonable. The problem with Sorcery Speed cards is that you don't get to Gearhulk them. You don't get to flash it back, which is the one thing that I wish we could improve. I don't really think there is anything instant speed that deals 3. Like, you can play Flame Sweep that deals 2. It doesn't deal with fires, though, so it's not going to kill. No, it doesn't deal with your flyers. So it still kills Gilded Goose? Yeah, okay. So it still kills Gilded Goose and stuff. But 2 damage is just not enough, I think. Like, 3 is more... Like, 3 toughness is more important. You get to kill... you know, Dreadhorde Arcanist, like some of the cards we just played against, like Mayhem Devil, just killing that is just so much more important than having the card be instant speed. I don't think there is anything instant speed 3 mana would deal 3, like that just doesn't exist, I don't think. Yeah, that was fun. That was a fun deck to play. We did some pretty crazy stuff with Bloodsun and Lotus Field. When you draw those two cards together, it feels pretty strong. Because this just replaces itself. You're not really losing any cards. You're not really, you know, skipping turns to do something. Like playing Bloodsun and Lotus, like you just have 3 on that mana right away, which is really cool. So like sometimes if you turn 3, you have to go Tails End, stifle my Lotus trigger. You still just tap out, still just let them do kind of whatever they want. But yeah, that felt pretty decent. The third disruption could be something else. Probably should be something else. Could just have one more Teferi, maybe. But I kind of just do want to have one more cheaper card, though. That makes more sense, I think. Like, you don't really lose the late game with this deck. You just have so much stuff to do. Like, between the Planeswalkers and Gearhulks and Epiphany and Shark Typhoon, commit to memory, you can start drawing again. It's actually pretty likely you can memory Narset somebody because you just have so much mana with the Lotuses. All right, one thing before I go. If you sign up for CIB Pro, not only do you have access to all the, you know, the deck vault and all the deck guides and Lewis's set reviews and all the, you know, draft guides and everything, but you also get access to the CIB Pro deals, which are deals that are only limited for CIB Pro members. They change every week, I think. There's always something cool to buy. You can buy a box, you can buy some, you know, singles sometimes. So yeah, check it out on channelfireball.com/CMB Pro Deals. And yeah, you should also sign up for CMB Pro. I think it's just a really cool thing to do. And they basically pay you to sign up. So, you know, you get everything back in store credit and sometimes even more. So you can just use that to, you know, get a box, draft with your friends or something. So make sure you check it out, channelfireball.com/CMB Pro Deals. And yeah, again, if you want to find the original creators of this deck, H0lydiva this way, spelled this way on Twitter, was where I got this deck from. I believe they might have gotten like a blue-red list from somebody else, but I don't remember the rest of the chain, you know, of the people who were working on it before, but you might just find it on their Twitter. So make sure you check that out. And yeah, thanks for watching. This was a fun deck, and it just shows you that Historic is a really fun format. It is still dominated by Uro. It is still like a format where, you know, tier one is Sultai, Goblins, and Jund Company. Like, those are pretty much the 3 strongest decks. Maybe it's kind of just Company and Sultai, because Goblins is always kind of just wildly played, but hasn't really had too great a win rate in any of the tournaments, even though, you know, Autumn took it to second place in the Mythic Invitational. But overall, the deck still doesn't have a great win rate. So Historic is still like a deck mostly dominated by Sultai and Company, Jund Company, or Jund Sacrifice if you want. But there's still a lot of room for innovation, and hopefully Galheim is gonna, you know, also bring something new, something interesting into the format, and we're gonna get to try more decks and try more stuff. So yeah, until then, thanks for watching.